If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Nehemiah chapter 4. Old Testament we're going today. Nehemiah chapter 4. That's not a book that we go to a lot, so if you have your Bibles, you may look at the table of contents. It's okay. That's what it's there for. Nehemiah chapter 4. Turn with me, scroll with me, click to Nehemiah chapter 4. All right, Nehemiah chapter 4, verses 1 through 9. Verse 1 says, "But it came to pass that when Sanballat heard that we built the wall, he was wroth and took great indignation and mocked the Jews. And he spake before his brethren and the army of Samaria and said, What do these feeble Jews? Will they fortify themselves? Will they sacrifice? Will they make an end in a day? Will they revive the stones out of the heaps of the rubbish which are burned? Now Tobiah the Ammonite was by him, and he said, Even that which they build, if a fox go up, he shall even break down their stone wall. Hear, O our God, for we are despised, and turn their reproach upon their own head, and give them for a prey in the land of captivity. And cover not their iniquity, and let not their sin be blotted out from before thee. For they have provoked thee to anger before the builders. So built we the wall, and all the wall was joined together unto the half thereof. For the people had a mind to work. But it came to pass that when Sanballat and Tobiah and the Arabians and the Ammonites and the Ashdodites heard that the walls of Jerusalem were made up and that the breaches began to be stopped, then they were very wroth and conspired all of them together to come and to fight against Jerusalem and to hinder it. Nevertheless, we made our prayer unto our God and set a watch against them day and night because of them." Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for all that you do. We thank you for your grace and your mercy, as always. Lord, as I stand here and proclaim your word on this morning, decrease all of me and increase all of you. Holy Spirit, have your way. It is in Jesus' name that we do pray. Amen. You may take your seats in the presence of the Lord. I want to come from the title today, Stay on the Wall. Stay on the Wall. Grace Center, it is not a new trend of how people will try to deter you from completing your assignment. It is not a new trend and not a new thing that people would try to destroy you just for you being you. It is not a new thing that individuals have been plotting and scheming against God's people. You see, many believers share a common thread with the biblical character Nehemiah. Who was Nehemiah? Well, Nehemiah was someone that loved the Lord.
Yes, sir. Amen.
He was a man of faith. He was also a man of courage. Nehemiah was also the cupbearer to the king. What is a cupbearer? Well, a cupbearer was someone in biblical times where they would sometimes taste the drink, whether it was wine or so forth. They would taste it before it is given to the king. They would do this to taste the quality of the wine just to make sure it was in good quality, or they also did it to taste it to see if there was some poison in the drink before it got to the king. Now that posed a great danger for the cupbearer, because if there was poison in the drink, and if the cupbearer drunk the drink, of course you know what happened. He died. So that position was a very dangerous position to have, but at the same time, it was a position of honor. So Nehemiah was a cupbearer to the king. And in biblical days, Grace Center, names meant something. Unlike today, where people would name their kids and give them names that makes no sense whatsoever. But in biblical days, names meant something. The name Nehemiah, it means, in the Hebrew, it means Jehovah comforts. Nehemiah means Jehovah comforts. What a great name to have, especially with everything that he had to go through. Jehovah comforts. Grace Center, your name may not be Nehemiah, but I want to let you know that during the most difficult days of your life, God will comfort you. He will comfort you. Just to rewind, and we'll fast forward in a second, but to give you the backdrop of what's happening here in the text, when you begin to read the book of Nehemiah, you'll see that Nehemiah, he's in the palace, and word comes to Nehemiah that back home in Jerusalem, the wall came down. The wall came down, it was burnt to the ground. People destroyed the wall, they burned it, and a lot of the wall was just rubbish. When Nehemiah heard this, Nehemiah was sad. He was upset at what was taking place here. Now, the purpose of the wall was to do several different things. One of the purposes was it would help protect the people from certain kinds of weather conditions and so forth, like strong winds and all of that. It would protect the people. That was one thing it was used for. Another thing the wall was used for was to protect the people from wild animals just coming into the city. Okay? Another purpose of the wall was that it would protect the people from their enemies. So it would protect the people from certain weather conditions, protect the people from wild animals just coming into Jerusalem, and it would protect the people from their enemies from trying to get inside of the city. It would help fortify the city. It would keep them secure. But now the walls of Jerusalem are rubble. And now the people are exposed. And the people are no longer safe. The people are now vulnerable to the attacks of their enemies. Once Nehemiah heard the news of his people, he mourned for his people. Yeah, but even during his mourning, Grace Center, Nehemiah took action. He was mourning, but he still took action. Yeah, Grace Center, it's okay to mourn, but while you're mourning, sometimes you still have to take some action. What did Nehemiah do? Well, the Bible says, watch this, it says he prayed and he fasted. He was in mourning, but he prayed and he fasted. Nehemiah prayed that God would, watch this, remember the promise that he also made to Moses. That if the people did sin, if they returned back to God, God would take them back in again. Nehemiah also prayed for favor with the king that he was the cupbearer to. So he prayed that God would remember his own promise not to forget them if they turn back to him. But he also prayed that God would show him favor with the king. The Bible says that Nehemiah, he began praying on the Jewish calendar. He began praying in the month of Chislev on the Jewish calendar. He began praying in the month of Chislev. Watch this. But God created an opportunity in the month of Nisan. He began praying in the month of Chislev on the Jewish calendar, but God created an opportunity in the month of Nisan. What does this all mean, Pastor? Watch this. About 148 days or so passed by from when Nehemiah began to pray and fast until God created an opportunity. Yeah, that's equivalent to about 5 months or so on our calendar. Yeah. Well, 5 months or so earlier, Nehemiah began to pray and began to fast. But God did not create the opportunity until about 148 days later, or about 5 months later. Yeah. God opened the door for Nehemiah to present his case to the king. Watch this. And it wasn't necessarily that Nehemiah started the conversation with the king about what took place in Jerusalem. No, God created the opportunity. Because in Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, the Bible says that when Nehemiah came into the presence of the king saw the sad countenance on the face of Nehemiah. Long story short, when the king asked Nehemiah what was going on, Nehemiah told the king what had taken place back home in Jerusalem, and then the king gave Nehemiah permission to leave and go back home and take care of the problem. Grace Center, when you pray and fast and seek the Lord, he will create an opportunity for you. Not only did God create this opportunity for Nehemiah, but watch this, God also provided the resources that Nehemiah needed to build the wall. God created the opportunity, he showed Nehemiah favor, but he also provided the resources. Nehemiah then began to build the wall, and when they began to build the wall, that's when the haters came out. The enemies, Grace Center, came out when they began to build this wall. That's how some people are. You know, the minute you start to move and do great things, they come out of hiding to try to tear you down and the very thing that you're trying to build. Verse 1 says, in Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 1 says, but it came to pass that when Sanballat heard that we built the wall, he was wroth, meaning he was upset, and took great indignation and mocked the Jews. So here you have one person mocking and teasing the Jews. Watch this, skip down to verse number 3. It says, now Tobiah the Ammonite was by him and said, even that which they build, if a fox go up, he shall even break down their stone wall. So at first we had one person upset with the Jews, but now you have two. You see, it doesn't take long for the enemy to recruit other individuals to join in to come against you. It don't take long. They heard them building the wall and they began to mock Nehemiah. Tobias said in verse number 3, and he even joked about this. He said, if a fox were to go up on the wall would come tumbling down. Greg said, you see, some people would try to dummy down your significance down to the level of their ignorance. Hey, let me rewind it real quick. Some people will try to dummy down your significance down to the level of their ignorance. Tobias said a fox. Not a lion, but a fox. Not a bear, but a fox. Not a hippo, but a fox. Not a giraffe, but a fox. An animal small in size. So when Tobias said a fox could make the wall come tumbling down, what he was really saying is that anything and everything you try to build, it will not last. That's what he was really saying. Anything and everything you're trying to build, it will not last. You're trying to rebuild your marriage. The devil is saying it will not last. You're trying to rebuild your career. The devil is saying it won't last. You're trying to rebuild relationships, but the devil is saying it won't last. You're trying to rededicate your life back to the Lord and give your life back to God, and the devil is saying it won't last. He's saying that what you're trying to achieve will crumble under the pressures of life. Yeah. He's saying no matter what you try to do, it's going to crumble. And when the enemy starts to tell you that it's not going to last and it's not going to work and it won't come to pass, you need to do the same thing that Nehemiah did. What did Nehemiah do? Well, look at verses 4 and 5. He started to pray. He started to pray. His enemies started talking, and Nehemiah started praying. Grace Center, the more the enemy talk, the more you need to pray. That was good. I like that right there. The more your enemies talk, the more you need to pray. The more you need to be on your knees. The more you may need to push away the plate. The more they talk, the more I'm going to pray. Keep on talking, devil. I'm going to keep right on talking to you. And who I'm talking to can get me out of the situation. So keep on running your mouth. I'll keep on running back to God. The devil, go run tell that. Because I'm going to run tell him. The more the devil talk, the more I'm going to pray. Nehemiah began to pray when his enemies began to talk. Verse number 6, it says, so built we the wall, and all the wall was joined together unto the half thereof. For the people had a mind to work. So here you have the wall. At this point, the wall is halfway done at this point. And the Bible says that they had a mind to work. The translation for mind to work here in this particular text, it means that they had heart. Okay, they had heart. They had a will to work. They had heart. Watch this. They did not lose heart even though they were being mocked and talked about. They never lost heart. Grace Center, your assignments that you have are too great for you to lose heart. The goals you're trying to reach are too important for you to lose heart. In the military, for anyone that was in the military, they'll tell you that one of the toughest things to do is to get past boot camp. If you get past boot camp, you're going to be all right. But the purpose of boot camp, Grace Center, is to flush your mind out of the civilian thinking and start thinking like a soldier or a marine or an airman or a sailor. It's not to think and have that civilian mind state. They're trying to train you to think like a soldier. Okay? And one of the things that drill sergeants would do, they will on purpose try to send you home. That's their goal. Their goal is to weed out the weak ones from the strong ones. They will on purpose try to send the weak ones back home to the homes. And say, I'm going to send you home today, private. Today, you're going home. You're not fit to be here in this military. It's the strongest military on the earth. And today, I'm going to send you home. They try to get in your head to send you home. They try to weed out the weak ones from the strong ones. After all, I don't want no weak ones in my military anyway, so get the weak ones out of here. We need some strong ones on the front line. So they were on purpose, Elder Coleman, try to send the weak ones home. So the strong ones will stay. The strong ones will remain. They try to get in your head, so they yell at you, they cuss at you, they spit all on you, they do all these things, wake you up at 3, 4 o'clock in the morning. Just hit a flashback. They do all these things to send you home. But if you survive, it shows that you got heart. It shows that I got a will to stay here. I got a heart to stay here. I have an assignment to complete the assignment. I'm going to stay right here because I have heart. The Bible says that the people, as they was building this wall, they had heart. They had a mind to work. They had a will to work. They were halfway at this point, but they still had heart. They was like, we're halfway done with this wall, and we're not going to stop right now. We can't stop, and we won't stop. We're going to keep right on going anyway. Grayson, whatever you have started, you need to finish the task. For some of you, you are halfway with your own spiritual walls. You don't need to get down from your wall. You don't need to turn around and tuck your tail in and run. You need to stay right there. Why? Because you got some heart. Verse 7 says, but it came to pass that when Sanballat and Tobiah and the Arabians and the Ammonites and the Ashdodites heard that the walls of Jerusalem were made up and that the breaches began to be stopped, then they were very wroth. They was wroth or upset before, but now they're very wroth. Do you know how to get the enemy really, really upset with you? Is to keep on keeping on. That's how you really get the enemy upset with you. You keep on keeping on. You keep right on doing what God has called you to do. But watch this. If you notice, Sanballat and Tobiah have some more backup here in the text. Yeah. Because at first it was just them. But now they have the Arabians and the Ammonites and the Ashdodites. Watch this. The intensity of the opposition grew as the Jews were almost complete with the wall. Grayson, as you get closer and closer and closer to fulfilling different assignments and reaching new heights and going to new levels, the intensity of the opposition, it gets greater. Yeah. And for some of you, you're probably asking the question, and that is, what in the world is going on? It could just be that you're on to something. Yeah. It could just be that you're about to reach the very thing that you're trying to reach. It could just be that you're about to touch the very thing that you're trying to touch. You're trying to obtain the very thing you're about to obtain. And now you've got the devil nervous. You've got the devil wringing his hand. Because you're about to reach the thing that you're trying to reach. And he's saying, I've got to get some backup. I've got to get some help. But the devil is a silly devil. Because it doesn't matter how much backup he gets, we also got backup too. As a matter of fact, our backup got backup, got backup.
You've got to fight for your destiny with one hand and defend all right? You have to be ambidextrous. Work with both of your hands at the same time. The enemy will speak one thing in one ear, feed your other ear with faith. The enemy wants you to look at your natural eyes and what's happening around you. But close your natural eyes. Open up your spiritual eyes and see what God is truly doing in your life. The Bible says they were working with one hand, but had a weapon in the other hand. They were multitasking at the same time. But Grace said they also had a strategy. They had a strategy, and their strategy was this. It was to pray, to watch, and work. To pray, to watch, and work. All three go hand in hand. I'm going to pray that God continues to give me the strength to keep on pushing. I'm going to watch for the haters at all times. But you can best believe I'm still going to work. I'm still going to work. Despite what the devil throws at you, despite the traps he sets for you, despite the lies he tells on you, continue to pray, watch, and work. Verse 18, I'm almost done. Verse 18 says this. It says, for the builders, everyone had his sword girded by his side, and so built. And he that sounded the trumpet was babbling. Grace said, while you are praying, watching, and working, don't forget the sword. The Bible says that the builders had the sword girded by their side. The sword was with them and on them at all times. In other words, we know the sword as being the word. At all times, Grace Center, we need to have the word within us. I've hidden your word in my heart so that I may not sin against you. You need to have the word in you so that when trouble come, and Grace Center, trouble will come, you've got the word in you at all times. As you're working and building and doing the things that God has called you to do, the devil is coming. But when the devil comes, just give him the word. Give him the sword. Cut him up with the sword, the word of God. When you continue reading this story, you will see how dedicated they were to building that wall. They were dedicated to building the wall. Grace, you know, whatever wall or assignment or goal that God has placed in your heart, stay on the wall. Don't lose heart, stay on the wall. Trouble will come, but stay on the wall. The winds will blow, but stay on the wall. Enemies will attack, but stay on the wall. People will turn their backs on you, but stay on the wall. Nehemiah and his men were dedicated to building this wall. You also see that they completed building this wall in 52 days. According to Nehemiah chapter 6, verse number 15, they completed building this wall in 52 days. Grace Center, there are 52 weeks in a year. And sometimes throughout the year, the enemy will try to make you believe that what you're fighting for is not worth it. He'll have you to think that what you are fighting for is not worth it. But I want to encourage you today to stay on the wall and to pray, to watch, to work, read the word, and stay on that wall. Watch this right here. Some of the greatest achievements are the toughest to achieve.
Yeah.
I think that bears repeating.
Yes, sir.
Some of the toughest
achievements are the toughest to achieve. I say this else in closing here. If God has called you for the assignment, He will equip you for the assignment. If He has called you for the assignment, He will equip you for the assignment. No matter how big you think it may be, no matter how large it may seem in your eyes, if He has called you to it, He has already equipped you for the assignment. He will show you favor like He showed Nehemiah with the king. He'll provide the resources for you like He provided Nehemiah to build the wall. He'll also bring the people to assist you like He also did Nehemiah as well. But what we have to do, Grace Center, is despite what may happen and whatever may come our way, we need to stay on the wall. Yes.